Welcome to the talk on succinct arguments and their application. I'm Katerina Sotiraki, and this is a joint work with Jonathan Bootle and Alessandro Chiesa. So the topic of this talk is succinct arguments. So let's start with the definition of what succinct arguments are. So in these protocols, we have two parties, a prover and a verifier, and they share some common input. The common input could be, for instance, an arithmetic circuit and a value, which in this case is equal to 10. In succinct arguments, the prover tries to convince the verifier that they know a witness for the common input. In this case, the witness sees some values that evaluate the arithmetic circuit to the common value 10. In the protocol, the prover and the verifier exchange messages, and at the end of the protocol, the verifier either accepts or rejects. So we require three properties from succinct arguments. The first one is called completeness, and it says that if the witness is valid, then the verifier should accept. The second one is soundness, and it says that if the witness is invalid, then the verifier should reject. And there are different notions of soundness. One of them that we consider is called knowledge soundness. Finally, we require succinctness. That means that the messages exchanged between the prover and the verifier should be way smaller than the size of the witness. A particular succinct protocol is the Sumcheck protocol, which was introduced in 92. In this protocol, the common input contains a polynomial P over a field F and a value U over the same field. The statement that the prover is trying to convince the verifier is that the evaluation of this polynomial over a subset H to the L is equal to the common value U. Again, we have a prover and a verifier and the exchange messages. In this case, the prover messages are some polynomials, some smaller polynomials than the common polynomial P, and the verifier messages are some random challenges from the set F. Finally, after they exchange the messages, the verifier performs some checks that are related to the messages sent by the prover, and the final check requires an evaluation of the polynomial P to a point defined by the challenge of the verifier. Notice that this protocol reduces the computation of the polynomial P over H to the L points to the evaluation of the P over a single point. The communication of the protocol is proportional to L, which is the number of variables in the polynomial P, and degree of P. And it's counted in elements of the finite field F. Finally, the soundness that this protocol offers says that if the sum of evaluations of the polynomial P is not equal to the value U, then the verifier accepts with probability that is proportional to L times degree of P over the size of F. The Sumcheck protocol is a very celebrated protocol. The first time that was used was in complexity theory, and in particular in probabilistic proofs. But since then, it has been used in many other areas, such as succinct arguments. And in fact, there have been many different versions of the Sumcheck protocol that have found many applications in succinct arguments. These versions include the univariate Sumcheck and the Sumcheck for tensor codes. Actually, Sumcheck has been so important that there have been blog posts with titles such as The Unreasonable Power of the Sumcheck Protocol by Justin Thaler. But why is Sumcheck protocol so important? A reason why this is the case is because this protocol has some very useful properties. In particular, in many settings, we can implement the prover in linear time. And also, in the prover in multiple settings can be implemented using a small space, namely as a streaming algorithm. Finally, the Sumcheck protocol has some very strong soundness properties, and which tell us that we can make it non-interactive without the use of random oracles. A different body of work in succinct arguments stems from a technique introduced in 2016 that it's called splitting fault technique. The first work that uses this technique constructs arguments for arithmetic circuits using based on the discrete logarithm assumption. Since then, there has been improvements and other arguments based on the discrete logarithm assumption. And this technique has been adapted to work in other settings, including the pairing group setting, the groups of unknown order setting, and the lattice setting. Apart from the individual cryptographic settings, there have been also some works on providing unified abstractions that try to capture many settings at once. This technique has also some, apart from the theoretical interest, has also some practical interest. In particular, it has been deployed in many cryptocurrencies and has been implemented in open source libraries. The split and fold technique shares some useful properties with the Sumcheck protocol. So the, in many settings, we can implement the prover in linear time, and also we can have a streaming prover that requires small space. So now that we have the background on succinct arguments and on these two types of work based on Sumcheck and split and fold, let me summarize our results. Our results basically say that even though we seemingly have two different techniques, one based on Sumcheck and the other on folding techniques, in reality, we can have a unified perspective that describes folding techniques through a variant of the Sumcheck protocol. We call this variant Sumcheck arguments. Our general goal is to provide succinct arguments for commitment openings. So let's see what these protocols are. Again, we have a prover and a verifier, but now their common input is a commitment and a commitment key CK. And the goal of the prover is to convince the verifier that they know a message M that's a valid opening of the commitment C. The succinctness goal says that the communication of this protocol should be way smaller than the size of the message M. And in order to get highly efficient and succinct arguments for commitment openings, we focus on commitments that have some very special structure. To describe this structure, we introduce the notion of Sumcheck-friendly commitments. In Sumcheck-friendly commitments, it's the commitment scheme has the following form. A commitment of a message M with respect to a key CK is can be written as a sum of evaluation of a polynomial. Let me break down this definition a little bit more. So first, the evaluation, the sum of evaluation is over a field or over a subset H of a ring R. Also, the commitment space is C. It should be an R module for the same ring R. Finally, on the right-hand side, the polynomial that we have to compute is split into two parts. The first one is called the message polynomial and is related to the message M. This is defined over an R module M, and a key polynomial, which is also defined over a different R module that we call K. Finally, these two polynomials, Pm and Pck, are combined through a combiner function that maps elements of M times K to elements of the commitment space C. This definition might be a bit too abstract, so I'll try to describe how a specific example through the Peterson commitments. In Peterson commitments, a commitment of a message is written as the sum of multiplications between message elements and key elements. So in this particular case, AI are the elements of the message and GI are the elements of the key. Then we can show that the Peterson commitment is a Sumcheck-friendly commitment by setting H to be equal to -1, 1, and R, the ring R, to be the finite field FP. Then the message space is the message polynomial is also defined over FP and is equal to a multilinear polynomial where the coefficients are equal to the message elements. Similarly, the key polynomial is defined over a group G and is also a multilinear polynomial with coefficients equal to the elements of the key. Finally, the combiner function maps a, g to a times g, which is an element of the group g. In the paper, we show some other examples of Sumcheck-friendly commitments, and these examples include the commitments related to scalar products. In this case, the commitment has three parts. The first two parts are Petersen commitments of messages A and B, and the third part is the scalar product of the two messages. And also commitments related to linear functions. In this case, again, the commitment has three parts. One of them, the first one, is related to the evaluation point, an evaluation point of the linear function. The second one is a commitment to the coefficients of the linear function. And the third one is the evaluation of the linear function on the point A, which can be written as a scalar product. So given the definition of Sumcheck-friendly commitments, we can describe our main theorem. So the main theorem says that if a commitment scheme is Sumcheck-friendly and it has some additional property that we call invertibility, then running the Sumcheck protocol on the polynomial P that as it's defined in the slide gives us a succinct argument of knowledge for the for commitment openings. Actually, we don't run exactly the Sumcheck protocol, but a slight variant of it, where we have an extra verifier check. And this protocol has the same properties as the Sumcheck. Something to observe is that the original Sumcheck protocol is defined over finite field F, whereas the polynomial that I define in the slide is over an R module. This is not an issue because we can easily extend Sumcheck to work over ring set modules. Also, in terms of the communication of the protocol, we should think of, in this case, of L times degree P as something that is logarithmic to the size of the opening, the commitment opening. Many prior works on Sumcheck-based succinct arguments and split and fold techniques get succinct arguments for NP by first reducing the NP statement to scalar products and then use efficient subroutines for scalar products. We use a similar strategy by constructing a Sumcheck argument for scalar products over bilinear modules and then reducing NP statements to this scalar product statements. For our NP statements, we use the R1CS problem. In this problem, we are given three matrices, A, B, and C, and we try to answer whether there exists a Z such that AZ times BZ is equal to CZ. And as I said before, we consider statements over bilinear modules, where a bilinear module is a collection of R modules equipped with a bilinear map. So this collection of modules must have enough structure to, for example, define Petersen commitment or run SNORM protocols. So given a bilinear module that has an extra property of being secure, then we can have zero knowledge succinct arguments for R1CS statements, where the R1CS ring is related to a module ML and an ideal I, and the prover and verifier time are linear in operations in the modules that are part of the bilinear module. Finally, the proof size is logarithmic in N, where N is the size of the witness Z. So let's see a few more details about bilinear modules. As we said, the bilinear module is a collection of modules. In particular, it has three modules, the left module ML, the right module RMR, and the target module MT. These modules are also equipped with a bilinear map, E, that maps elements of ML times MR to an element of MT. We should think, in our commitment schemes, we should think of small elements of ML as the message space, elements of MR as the key space and elements of MT as the commitment space. Finally, the binding assumption of a commitment scheme is reduced on assumption that we call bilinear relation assumption. Let's see what that means for the example of Petersen commitment. As we said before, a Petersen commitment is a scalar product between the message and the key. Then if we want to define a Petersen commitment over a bilinear module, then we can multiply messages and keys using the bilinear map E. We can add them together using the fact that elements in AI, GI belong to an R module MT. And the binding of the scheme is reducing to finding small messages A such that A, G is equal to zero. And this is exactly what we call the bilinear relation assumption. In the paper, we give different instantiations of bilinear module, including settings such as the discrete logarithm, the pairing, groups of unknown order, and ring SIS. A particular instantiation is the lattice-based instantiation, which gives us succinct arguments of knowledge for R1CS based on a lattice assumption, in particular the ring SIS assumption. I should also mention that there have been some concurrent work in this space that also appear in this crypto. Specifically, there is a work that gives a lattice-based succinct arguments for NP that uses split and fold techniques. And also there's another work that shows some impossibility results on the efficiency of this instantiation and also provides different instantiations of lattice rings for the ring SIS assumption. So let me conclude with some open questions. First, an interesting question that we don't answer in this work is related to the post-quantum security of Sumcheck arguments, and specifically how we can analyze the security when the prover and the verifier are quantum. Also, another interesting direction is to investigate the new lattice instantiation in this concurrent work and see whether we can have concrete performance improvements. And finally, even though our framework encompasses most of the split and fold techniques, there are still some works that we cannot describe. So it's interesting to see whether we can have a generalization of our framework that also includes these works. The key takeaways of our work is that many commitment schemes can be thought as Sumcheck friendly. Also, we can recast the many different cryptographic settings as bilinear modules. And finally, I would like to point to the paper for more information about the instantiations and the proofs, and also for constructing polynomial commitment schemes over bilinear modules. Thank you for listening.